I'm in Leipzig, and you can see that it's become sort of one big shopping mall here in East Germany. And of course, over here, they did not call themselves East Germany. They called themselves the GDR, which is the German Democratic Republic, which was essentially a part of the Soviet Union when they built the wall in order to keep people from moving west. And what's really interesting about all of this is I tried thinking, you know, why is it that so many major cities, despite the technology that is now far more advanced than automobiles, why is it that we've sort of consented to a situation where, you know, in an age you can order anything online and have it delivered to your house in a few days? Why is it that so much of this infrastructure, so much of this space is dedicated to shopping? And of course, the infrastructure to get us there with the automobile and all these different logistics companies. And the answer, I think, actually lies right here in Leipzig and in the GDR. A lot of the protests that eventually led to the fall of the Berlin Wall, which is not that far from here, happened right here in this city. Not with that church, but a different one called St. Nicholas. And what's interesting is that by the time it was 1989, in early or mid-1989, it really looked like the Soviet Union back in Moscow didn't have the energy or the money to essentially snuff out protests or to maintain its security infrastructure, even though we know that the Stasi was one of the most powerful surveillance agencies in the whole world, especially at the time. And so what ended up happening was people sort of met in these churches. It was not as cloak and dagger as in Prague or as creative. And they protested nonviolently. And those protests started out as 70,000 and then eventually spread all the way to Berlin. And then a few months later led to the Berlin Wall being smashed in all the different iconic photos that we've all seen. And as I'm here and I can appreciate the history, I can also appreciate why, when the wall came down, so many people on this side of the wall were so happy to have choices. And they were, for the first time, able to have bananas, which, you know, is not something that is easily grown here. It's usually grown in a tropical climate. And for the first time, they had choices that people in the West, more specifically the United States, took for granted. And, you know, when the wall did come down, the West Germans actually gave them a small allowance so they could come to West Germany and spend some money. I think it was about 50 Deutschmarks. And one of the photos in National Geographic is of this, you know, very plump grandmother happily peeling a banana in her car. And so you see that these choices and this idea behind having consumer choice was something that was alien to the GDR. But now, you know, it's something where it may have sort of spiraled out of control when we have technology that allows us to have whatever we want just by clicking on something on a screen. And this is not something we should underestimate, because if you work in retail, you know that, you know, the products that come in typically come in by truck. They get loaded on to either a conveyor belt or a pallet. And then people like me, or typically people that earn minimum wage, then have to unload those pallets into one of these stores, into one of these shopping malls, and into one of these retail centers that you can then see. And in a case of clothing, it kind of makes sense because, you know, you want to try it on, especially with shoes. But in almost every other instance, whether it's food or any kind of non-perishable product, it's highly inefficient to have a structure where you're simply sort of moving things from one place in the back into the front when the technology today allows you to simply, you know, just have that transported immediately to your home. Using a shuttle, using the same logistics systems that have made FedEx and DHL so vast all over the world. And so we're looking at a world where it's, again, interesting that we're having this conversation here, because one of the reasons the Soviet Union failed was because its plan of, you know, commoditizing agriculture and having it shipped from its territories in the West to back to Moscow failed. Because it's not that the people here were starving, it's just they were starving for choice. And so because the supply chain in the Soviet Union era was not perfected, because the technology just wasn't there yet, the Soviet Union eventually lost its grip, especially when faced with competition from the West, which, you know, of course had a powerful navy and the currency and the financial system to promote development of that supply chain. And of course, China today has taken over with respect to the supply chain where the Soviet Union left off. And one of the advantages of having a system here that was that promoted infrastructure is, of course, you have a fast train system, one of the fastest trams and train systems I've ever seen. They're not sort of as slow as the ones that I'm used to back in San Francisco. But again, you have to look at a couple of other things. One of the leaders of the resistance was in Prague, Vaclav Havel. And they kept talking about this idea of a totalitarian state. How do you beat a totalitarian state once it's taken over? And he says that all these radicals, they don't understand. There might be a particular moment, like in Hungary in 1958, when you can resist. But once the totalitarian state has, you know, taken over, you end up in a position where if you try to fight it, you either become bitter, you start to think that people are not as radical as you are, and essentially you end up apathetic and in exactly the kind of place that the totalitarian state wants you to be in. And so he promoted the idea, and this is the eventual president of Czechoslovakia, he promoted the idea of these parallel structures, essentially a grassroots from the bottom up movement of individuals that were living in truth. And the idea behind that, especially coming from somebody that, you know, was forced to work as a brewer, just, you know, basically making beer for some time as a result of being blacklisted based on his writings. You know, the result of all of that was that his idea was you have to have this parallel structure that can operate with the totalitarian state that works its way up. And that way, the people are able to change the leadership without having too many massive problems in the overall structure. And if the leaders are not responsive, then you have a situation where you can replace them with somebody who is responsive without upsetting the economy or the social structures that you've built from a grassroots level excessively. So without upsetting those structures excessively. Now, what's interesting here again is not only this idea that we've gone from a lack of choice to too many choices. This is something that Alexander Solzhenitsyn, he was the one that was, again, in exile in the West. And he gave a speech in Harvard where he talked about in 1978, the decline of the West because of too many consumer choices. And it's very conservative for somebody who has, you know, and he starts out by saying that if I were in the East speaking to my own people, I would have a different speech. But because I'm here in the West, I can only talk about what I can see here. What I see here is freedom without responsibility, without obligation, which isn't really freedom at all. And so you look, and he also blamed in 1978 this idea of mass consumerism eating at the soul without having something to, you know, give it meaning. And you can see that all these structures that have been built since then, a lot of them are obviously necessary, housing, but you can also see that the world doesn't have to be this way with asphalt roads and all these different structures. You can see that the whole world can be completely different. You can have a situation where you can walk from one place to the next, hop on a train, and have a system that allows you to, you know, have an educational system that's close by, that maybe is vocational, all of which would be within walking or train distance or bus distance. And for the most part, the Germans have done an excellent job trying to meet those standards, trying to meet that bottom-up structure that Havel talked about. And the point of that structure, of that parallel structure, of that pre-political parallel structure that Havel talks about, is that you, by creating that structure, you either force the other side, the state, to live up to its laws, to live up to its ideas, and in doing so, soften its stance and become more liberal. Because again, just by replacing a leader at the top, you cannot change the entire structure that's been built from the grassroots all the way up to that leader. But he also talked about either that happens or the movement gets crushed and the totalitarian state wins. And my, what I can see here today is that you have essentially a shift, not necessarily of too much consumerism, but a lack of imagination. Because you can easily imagine a library on every block instead of a shopping mall on every block. And in some cases, people are trying to do that. They have these little birdhouses that, you know, you can go in and take a book and put a book, and but that's not enough. And even Havel talks about the fact that at some point an organization gets bigger, it has to have some kind of a centralized organizational structure. But again, he was talking about different community structures, local structures from the bottom up. And in some cases, with these are attempts that people have made. You have unions, you have community centers, you have local governments. And in the United States, a lot of these structures have themselves become corrupt. And so you get to the point where you realize that infrastructure and the way you design cities is vital to preventing corruption. In the sense that if you don't build a system where people can talk to each other easily or get information easily without perhaps taking a loan out on a car, you create a system where the leadership, even if you elect it from the bottom up, still has access to information and laws and lawmaking skills and funding powers that allow an imperfect informational chain to go all the way from the top to the bottom. So in other words, the influence continues to stay at the top, especially if there is no reform in the police, the military, and what Havel talks about in terms of the government agencies that can use force. And so one of the problems that people have now is that they're talking about a lack of development. In other words, all these capital cities have been developed. That's a good thing. Now we need to develop places like this. But the problem is the development is merely an extension of what's happening in the capital city, which is a generic structure that was built not necessarily for communication purposes or to respect Havel's ideal society. It's just something that's been done before. People know it works. The local government planning commission are able to rubber stamp it because they know the developers. And one day you wake up and you live in a society where it really looks like the military did not win World War II. If you had to walk in a street without knowing any history, and you came down from planet Mars, you would think, if you were told that there was a war, that the people who won were the mall developers, were the real estate companies. Those are the people that won. And this idea of development, for the sake of development, is something that probably has to change. And in fact, it has to change because you're creating a society where you've got, and I'm trying to figure out the words to describe this. You know, you've got a society where, well, look at this. There's nobody, just two people on the street. So many more cars than people. This is not an ideal society, but especially not in truly developing societies, countries, and cities, where you just can't do something like this without bulldozing an entire city. Because in the old days, the development structure has not quite extended to, say, Northern Africa. They may have a tram, but the system of infrastructure is different because it was either the French rather than the English or the Americans that came in. And so you have all these different structures that necessitate their own planning. But if it's the same real estate companies that are involved with the same banks that are involved that backstop those developers, you're going to end up with the same city with the same problems. And it may be the case that you have all the right ideas and all the right intentions, food security, local agriculture, a supply chain that can now be perfected much more easily than in the past. And so you can probably get whatever plan that you want to put in place done. But the problem is the plan that you most people put in place lacks imagination. And so we're going to end up, if this continues, with the exact same city, the exact same people, and the exact same problems that happened in the past. And Germany is doing a much better job than other places. But I can't help but think that we've sort of listened to Havel and understood his words and somehow tried to fulfill his vision of a full human life, living in truth. And he actually is one of the few philosophers that mentions love. You talk about all these different values, and like many people that were either in exile or oppressed by a totalitarian state, he really does focus on the abstract. And he tries to make, within his own philosophy, the abstract more concrete through the political structures. And his whole idea is, if you can't do it through, you know, the normal political structure, you have to create another one. And the problem now is we have all these different structures. And for the most part, you have unions, you have school boards, you have local governments. But it really doesn't seem as if it's getting the vision done. So it's possible to have more than one parallel structure. And if you're in Leipzig, it's sort of a hippie-ish college town. And I think that one of the problems is that, you know, we're in a society that, you know, likes to, you know, brag about how evolved it is, rather than trying to focus on how to, you know, create a society that is different from the one before it. And it's hard. It's hard because you're in a position where you don't actually have access to the planning commission if you're 25 years old or 28 years old. You don't know how to build, you know, entire condos from the ground up. Somebody else has all that knowledge. And so it is a lot easier to just put a, you know, anti-AFD, the anti-immigrant party, you know, the sticker. You can put a sticker, and that's what's in my Airbnb now. There's an anti-AFD sticker there. And you end up in a position where a lot of it just looks like posturing. It's good posturing. I like going into an Airbnb and seeing a sign, that's a sticker that says, you know, refugees welcome. But it's not enough. And so, on the one hand, we've come a long way. On the other, you know, on the other hand, we're still right back, you know, right back in 1945. In the sense that these buildings are probably the exact same design that the Soviets had in 1945, but maybe you added a balcony. And so these streets are, again, the same kind of streets that you would have had that the Soviets could have built in 1945. But maybe there's a little bit, I'm not even sure if it is any different. Maybe there's a different design, but I certainly can't see it. Even these cars, if you look at the Lada, this actually looks like a Lada. This is the very basic Russian car. You come over here, of course you've got a really nice shiny car over here. But you know, only a few of us will be able to own it. But these cars, like Skoda, which is a Czech company, again, all these things, you really could be in 1945 right now. And that's a problem that I have with so many of the current political structures, whether they're part of the establishment or part of that parallel structure that Havel was talking about in his book, by the way, The Power of the Powerless.